up, heathens? I'm Happy Viking, and welcome once again to my motion picture review show, where I take filmmaking to the chopping block and deconstruct, dissect, and disembowel it as only a Viking can. Because, hey, I'm a deadly and dangerous Dane who loves the darker side of life. And speaking of, we're talking about another such person today, Danish filmmaker Nicholas Winding Refn.
Nicholas Winding Refn is fucking radical, and he occupies the interesting niche of being a Danish director that I can be unambiguously proud of. I mean, sure, he's a kooky, complicated man with a passion for extravagant violence who's a little up his own ass, but at least he doesn't make weird, awkward statements about being a fucking Nazi.
What can I say? I understand Hitler.
Von Trier, go home. You're drunk. And shockingly racist. Maybe. I don't know. Anyway, this dude is awesome, and his movies, equally so. Drive, Bronson, the Pusher trilogy, Refn makes badass movies for badass people that manage to be brutal as hell, yet simultaneously subtle and evocative.
But the movie we have today is proof that sometimes too much of a good thing is a bad thing. A movie that is as unbearably brutal as it is unbearably subtle. A movie called Valhalla Rising.
Driven by hate, so he survives. Why never loses?
Ah yes, Valhalla Rising. Good God, where do I even start with this thing? First of all, this movie is not a 300-style action movie with Vikings in it. This DVD cover is a goddamn lie. It's nothing like that. This movie is nowhere near that simple and straightforward. Quite the opposite, in fact. Valhalla Rising is difficult. It's a ponderous, meditative, and minimalist journey into the heart of darkness. It's quiet, brooding, and soul-crushingly bleak, with its long stretches of ominous pretension punctuated by shocking displays of violence and depravity.
So, basically, it's an art film, and I will admit I am grotesquely out of my element when it comes to reviewing these.
I'm pretty sure there's at least one highfalutin, highbrow fancy pants out there who's more suited to reviewing this sucker than I am.
But it's a Viking movie and it needs a Viking reviewer. But since I am reviewing what is quite possibly the most abstract and complex Viking movie ever made, I'm gonna need to summon all of my Vikingly powers. So for this I'll need a Viking horn, a Viking beer, and most importantly, a Viking set. So, now that I'm properly attuned to the strength of my ancestors through the magic of heightened production value, let's experience Valhalla Rising.
The movie starts with a short bit of text describing the setting. Basically, it's set during the time of the Crusades, where the Christians were getting seriously militant and slowly destroying the pagans and driving them to the edges of the earth. It's a dreadful and violent time, so yeah, expect tons of dread and violence. It's basically the movie's stock and trade. Anyway, the movie proper starts on a foggy mountain where we see a pagan camp with pagan sentries standing around looking stoic and rad. A young boy with a bucket full of slop approaches one of the wooden cages and feeds an imprisoned slave. That slave, called One Eye, is our protagonist. He is a stoic man with no past and no future who never says a word.
Who are you?
There's very little dialogue in this movie, and no names are actually given for any of the other characters. The storytelling is extremely minimalist, and as such, the film basically runs on imagery and atmosphere. And when it's not doing that, it's beating the fuck out of somebody. One Eye, as a slave, is made to fight in gladiator-style matches by his master for his fun and profit. Well, I'm assuming they're having fun. Everyone looks like a big ol' sourpuss in this movie. Cheer up, you guys.
And as you would naturally expect from the guy who directed Drive, these fights are fucking gruesome. Oh, wow, that is just way too much. Play it again. Cool.
Like I was talking about earlier, if there's anything you can count on in a Refn film, it's brutality. Ceaseless, unrelenting, visceral brutality. and he's very good at it. See, Valhalla Rising is all about creating an atmosphere of dread and unease, and everything contributes really well to that atmosphere, from the brutal violence to the dark musical score to the medieval setting itself.
A much-traveled man once told me that they eat their own god, eat his flesh, drink his blood. Abominable. And hate us. What is dead?
Like I said, dread and violence.
Also, dude, it's pretty hard to claim the moral high ground when you're gambling over slave death matches that you hold with your dickhead buddies. But what do I know? I'm a 1,200-year-old murderer, so who am I to judge?
Anyway, that's One Eye's whole life. Day after day, he fights for his life and performs menial labor for his captors, and when they don't need him, they chain him up inside a cage like a wild animal. The only person that doesn't treat One Eye like a chump is the kid here, who actually has the decency to feed him. Even if said food looks like a bowl full of yak semen, but whatever. One Eye's happy just so long as he's not eating someone's neck flesh.
So yeah, One Eye's life kinda sucks, but of course, it wouldn't be a very good movie if you just spent the whole film being someone's bitch. So naturally, destiny intervenes. Quite literally.
Throughout the movie, One Eye has visions of the future, such as this one, which reveals to him the location of an arrowhead that he uses to cut his bindings and kill all of his captors.
What do you see? Yourself?
No, can't say I do. Although that one cloud does kinda look like a bunny rabbit.
What does he mean by that? Is he talking about One Eye's visions? How would he know about those? Well, whatever. I'm sure it'll make sense later.
When I die, you will go back to hell.
Oh no, you didn't! One Eye is sick of taking the fat man's shit, so he responds as any normal person would, by cutting open his belly and spilling his guts upon the ground. Jesus, dude.
He's driven by hate.
No kidding. I wonder why.
So he survives. Why never loses. He'll come because he has to come. To finish it.
I want that quote on my gravestone.
So One Eye, having viscerally pwned his captors, wanders off into an unknown world and... Kid, what are you doing? Kid, why are you following him? This dude just killed your family and everyone you ever cared about. Kid! Ugh, dumb blonde. So, yeah, the kid tags along with One Eye for some reason, and the two go wandering somewhere, and he basically serves as One Eye's mouthpiece for the rest of the movie. So One Eye sees a vision of himself on a boat with a bunch of dudes.
Well, hopefully they'll provide better company than his former captors. I mean, those assholes made him do bitch work like rock moving and skull crushing. These guys couldn't possibly be worse.
Oh, shit. Okay, these guys might be dicks. Those guys are Christian soldiers, and they're just as abominable as the old man said. Look at this shit. Murder? Burning the bodies? Implied rape and or innocent mud wrestling? Yeah, true men of God right here. And it's clear that despite the fact that One Eye ate some dude's jugular and tore open a guy's gut with an arrowhead, he's disgusted by these fuckers.
And really? Who wouldn't be? Were this movie made about any other Viking, like say, me? These guys would have been chokeslammed into oblivion, their lady captives freed, and the hero would have driven off into the sunset on a sweet dirt bike that I'll totally buy when I get my income tax return back. Sorry, what was I talking about?
Anyway, upon learning of the smelly pagans in his midst, the head honcho here, the general, draws his sword. But he's quickly talked down by the soldier over there.
Who would do that if I were you. He's one of the biggest savages in Sutherland. Killed our chieftain's son. And most of his men as well.
So, having been informed about how dangerous One Eye is, the general does the smart thing and...
Son!
Sends his son out to fight him? My God, this guy's a dick! Fortunately for him, Sonny Jim wisely backs down. Aw, yeah, boy, you better run! Nobody fucks with Mads Mikkelsen! Well, unless he's playing Le Chiffre, in which case he's kind of a chump.
So all the Christians are convinced of One-Eye's badassitude, but rather than just letting the dangerous man that they're all afraid of go on his merry way, they try something dumber and attempt to recruit him.
We're God's own soldiers, warrior, heading for Jerusalem to reconquer the Holy Land. I could use a good fighter like you.
You sure that's a good idea, Chief? He's a heathen warrior who's driven by hate, and the last people who pushed him around got killed pretty fucking hard. Why do you want him around?
Maybe he could bring us luck.
Define luck. Is he killed our chieftain's son and most of his men as well your definition of luck? I'm pretty sure that's not luck. That sounds like the other thing.
One Eye has bad luck written all over him. The kid literally says he's from hell.
Boy. Where does he come from?
He was brought up from hell.
So where is it in this hell?
On the other side of the ocean.
Ooh, that's not foreshadowing at all. But despite being a terrible idea, the Crusaders still try to get him on board. They promise him honor, riches, and land for his services, but One Eye is not buying it.
So One Eye isn't interested in tagging along with a bunch of dickheads for promises of honor and wealth. But we know through his vision that he ends up going with them anyway. So, what convinces him?
Endless warfare. It makes more tramps than heroes.
The priest. This guy is great. He's the most sympathetic Christian by far. All the other guys are bloodthirsty rapist dipshits, whereas the priest is warm, sincere, and compassionate. And rather than tempt One Eye with promises of gold, he suggests coming along to earn forgiveness and absolution. You know, Christian shit.
We're more than flesh and blood, more than revenge. You should consider your soul. That's where the real pain lies.
That gets his attention. So he ends up joining them. And then disaster strikes. En route to the Holy Land, their ship gets lost in a thick, unrelenting fog. This unnatural fog lasts for days, possibly weeks, and little by little, everyone goes mad. One of the Crusaders even tries to kill the kid, thinking he's cursed. It ends predictably. However, not everyone is a dick to children. The priest has the common dignity to try and comfort him and simultaneously explain his beliefs to him.
Do you know what I do when I'm scared? I pray to Christ. He sacrificed his life so that we could be free from pain.
Yes, Christ has clearly freed people from pain and misery. The irony of this statement is as thick as the fog that's killing them.
And there's a lot of pain and misery ahead, too. This movie only gets more bleak and grim from here on out. And keep in mind, you've already seen this happen. And yes, I am deliberately bringing up that clip just to make you feel uncomfortable. Ain't I just a stinker?
They're on this boat for a while, so let me dig into this brief bit of criticism while I can. This movie is fucking slow. Valhalla Rising is so slow it makes Blade Runner look like a Benny Hill sketch. As a result of the storytelling being so sparse and minimalist, the pacing had to be slowed down to glacier-like levels in order for it to last an hour and a half. Now, of course, I understand the benefits of a gentle pace and how it can add to a film's ambiance, but for fuck's sake, there are limits. Look how long it takes for the priest to respond to this dude's question.
Do you think he'll come back?
It's God's will.
Like, 10 seconds, and it's 10 seconds that contribute nothing to the atmosphere. It feels artificial, and it's during the boat scene in particular where it's most noticeable. Everyone is languishing in their own despair, doing nothing, on a static set with shots that last forever.
It's just boring and tiring. Sleep-inducing. Fuck! God damn it, movie!
So he has a vision. What's it of? Water. And that's it. Oh, fuck me, we're gonna be here forever. But then something happens. One Eye fills a mug with seawater and drinks it. And then he passes it to the soldier. And guess what?
It's fresh water.
Give me that shit! The fog at long last dissipates and they find themselves in a strange new land. But it's not the Holy Land. It's North America.
So, considering they crossed the Atlantic, that means they were at sea for about 4 or 5 fucking weeks. Why aren't they fucking dead?
Who cares? I'm just happy that stuff is finally happening again. Okay, at this point, we're halfway through the movie, and very little has actually happened. One Eye escaped slavery, joined some crusaders, got lost on a boat, and wound up in North America. In 45 minutes. I really wasn't kidding when I said the storytelling was sparse. There's not really much in the way of plotting or dialogue or characterization or anything. Stuff just kinda happens and you're just along for the ride. Which is okay, I just wish I knew where the hell the ride was going. Anyway, they moor the boat and go ashore to get their bearings and explore their new surroundings. It's not great. They find a number of creepy as hell ritual sites, one of their crusader brethren goes missing in the woods, and for the first time in the movie, One Eye looks absolutely terrified. And then he gets a vision. A vision of a scary man covered in ritual markings pointing at the group threateningly for setting up a cross. Well, that's a pretty straightforward warning. Okay, so what we need to do is absolutely not set up any... Oh, goddammit.
I'm gonna show them a man of God has arrived.
Well, you sure showed them. Oh man, things are not looking good here. Maybe we should just skedaddle and get the hell out of...
Ah!
Anyone else think it's a little jarring to hear crusaders drop the F-bomb? Especially in a movie like this with so little dialogue? Here's what it sounds like to me.
Fuck! Fuck, 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 oh, fuck, shit! Fuck! Oh, fuck!
I just used Tourette's guy in a review for an art film. I truly am a professional.
Just to recap, they're slowly being hunted by barbarians in an unknown land while also slowly starving, dying, and losing their minds. Jesus, the fat man was right. One Eye did go back to hell.
Oh, wait. Shit just clicked. The movie is saying that hell is nature. Bear with me for a minute. Let me explain.
The very first thing the movie tells us is that in the beginning, there was man and nature. So clearly, man versus nature is a big theme here. Now, look at the stark contrast between the New World and the Old World. Rugged and desolate, lush and green. Clearly trying to evoke nature in its purest form. Now, given that, what exactly is nature according to this movie? Scary, grim, ominous, crushing, bleak, brutal, and painful. That sounds like hell. So we can say that hell is pain. Thus, nature is pain. And when you think about it in those general terms, when the fat man talked about One Eye going back to hell, he could have been talking about him going back to being no more than a brutal animal, no more than a slave. And what got him out of there? His visions. Visions which are, throughout the movie, implied to be God's will.
He sacrificed his life so that we could be free from pain.
Man, oh man, it's just coming together.
You with me so far? Nature is hell, thus nature is pain. And we can rise above nature and free ourselves from pain with the power of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Zodiological astronomy was created by the Greeks in
785 BC.
785 is the area code to Topeka, Kansas.
Cold Kansas!
Man, why aren't I watching Black Dynamite right now? That movie was so much less complicated.
Okay, enough of all that ass-backwards film analysis. Where was I? Oh yeah, everything is unbelievably fucked and they're all going to die. The General is more optimistic, however. And by optimistic, I mean completely insane. He thinks God brought them there to claim the New World in his name and start a New Jerusalem.
How do we do that?
Simple, my friend. We get crunk. And so, everyone does, and they drink from this ceramic jug that the General just found, I guess. I wonder when he plans on telling them that they're drinking from a chamber pot. And right after he takes a swig, One Eye has one last complete vision. That of his own death. Heavy.
Okay, before now the movie was slow and ominous and steeped in vague symbolism, but otherwise kinda straightforward. But this is where Valhalla Rising goes nuts and becomes even more disturbing and cryptic, because I don't know what the General put in that drink, but it makes everyone lose their fucking minds.
This is the creepiest and most unsettling part of an already dark movie. It's a 5-minute montage of despair set to really unsettling music, wherein One Eye builds his own gravestone, the General hopelessly calls out to God, while his own son lays down in the muck looking forlorn and completely broken while... Oh, hey soldier. What you doing? Keeping it real? That's good. I was just... Dude, what are you... Oh, God.
Yeah, that happened. Crusader butt sex. I did not want to see Crusader butt sex. Why did Refn feel it necessary to show me Crusader butt sex? Ugh, that leaves such a bad taste in my mouth. It tastes like butt sex. Ugh, I need a palate cleanser. Show me that skull-crushing scene again. Oh, that's so good.
So yeah, One Eye's visions appear to have been leading to his death all along. God, what dicks. His visions are dicks, the Crusaders are dicks, his captors were dicks, the natives are dicks, everybody in this movie's a fucking dick. Dick, dick, dick. Okay, enough about dicks. Let's keep the story going. Remember when I said one of the dudes went missing? He comes back. Differently. By which I mean covered in mud and ritual markings looking traumatized. But that's not the weirdest part. It's what he says about One Eye.
Can you not hear him? He talks. He says we're in hell.
Oh, shit. Well, the soldier gets pissed, blames One Eye for the whole fiasco, and tries to kill him. Doesn't work. In these last few moments, he's probably thinking that, in retrospect, bringing the heathen warrior who was driven by hate with them wasn't the best of ideas. Oh well, live and learn. Or not.
No.
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 No. Nice acting there, Chief. I appreciate your decision to be just as dull and muted as the rest of the film.
After putting down his assailants, One Eye departs into the woods to meet his destiny head-on, with the boy not far behind. The priest tells the General that they should follow him. He doesn't take it well.
My lifelong friend. Will you turn your back on me?
So the General, continuing in his duties of being an outrageous nutcase fuckface, stabs the priest in his lung for daring to side with the heathen and sends him on his way. So the priest and the General's son follow One Eye and the boy into the woods and up a mountain. And then we cut back to the General as he's going on and on about how rad his New Jerusalem is going to be, about how it's going to have blackjack and hookers, and the mud-covered dude just laughs in his fucking face. And then he dies. Yup, pretty anticlimactic.
And that's why you always listen to One Eye. That dude has all the answers. He's basically like Jesus. Oh, and speaking of One Eye being Jesus... One Eye becomes Jesus. I'm not really even joking. That's the basic gist of the next scene.
On top of the mountain, the priest and the general's son confess their sins and doubts to One Eye, who's backlit in the most blatantly symbolic way. He's basically Viking Jesus now. Yeah, this looks like a good time to do some more boring-ass analysis. I watched a couple interviews with Refn because, Valhalla Rising being what it is, I wanted to figure out what his thoughts were making this movie.
Valhalla Rising was meant to be a Viking action movie, and I ended up making a Viking science fiction film in a metaphysical way.
Dude, you're not helping.
But beyond science fiction, because nothing to do with science, it's more like looking beyond the stars in a way.
Okay, that makes more sense. So the movie is meant to be introspective, meant to talk about things that are above and beyond us.
And you kind of say that Bronson was about a man who creates his own mythology. Valhalla Rising is about mythology.
There we go. That sums it up right there. Valhalla Rising is about mythology. Not Christian or Norse or anything else, just mythology and myth-making in general.
One Eye starts the film as a slave driven by hate, becomes a free man with dreams of redemption, and at the end basically becomes a god. The movie is about One Eye becoming a mythological figure by overcoming the brutal hell of nature and rising above it. The rise of a myth. Valhalla Rising.
Yes, I'm the greatest! I just successfully analyzed an art film. That makes me better than 90% of the internet reviewer community. So suck it, nerds! Ha ha ha! This video will still only get about 200 views, though, so, yeah, joke's on me.
Okay, we're at the final stretch. Let's see what happens. The general's son heads back down the mountain to be with his father, knowing that he's likely dead by now. The priest succumbs to his wounds and dies, albeit in possibly an even more blatantly symbolic way, and One Eye and the boy forge onward, eventually meeting the shoreline, but they look back to see themselves surrounded by angry natives. One Eye, nutting up and facing destiny like an OG, throws down his weapons and sacrifices himself for the child.
It's a shame to see him go, but at least here he dies on his own terms. Unlike in Casino Royale where he died scratching Daniel Craig's balls.
Now the whole world's gonna know that you died scratching my balls!
So One Eye dies, the kid lives and probably grows up to be the guy from Pathfinder, and the last shots of the movie are of One Eye's face in the clouds above the old world, mimicking the signature shot from his visions. Apparently, the original ending Refn envisioned was for One Eye to hop on a spaceship and take off into the sky. I'm dead serious. Apparently, he changed it because he said it would have been, I shit you not, too easy to interpret.
Yes, One Eye phoning home and boarding a fucking spaceship would have been, in Refn's mind, insultingly straightforward. Actually, I kind of wish they stuck with Jesus being a spaceman who fucks around with Vikings, because then this movie would basically be Outlander.
No, after watching this film maybe two or three times, the symbolism is fairly clear to me. Like Refn said, the movie is about mythology. It's about monolithic figures who strive to rise above the bleak and senseless brutality of nature and become something noble. That's why all the violent dickheads die horribly and why everyone who isn't a dick is allowed, if not to live, then to die with peace and dignity. It's violent and uncompromising, but still very thoughtful and spiritual. It's basically Refn at his most Refn.
As for what I thought of Valhalla Rising as a film, I'm torn. It's one of those rare times where when someone asks me if I liked the film, all I can say is, I don't know.
The cinematography, sound design, and atmosphere are all fantastic. The movie looks, sounds, and feels good. Well, as good as Crusader butt sex can feel anyway. Ugh. But the sparse and desolate storytelling can be a little frustrating, especially when combined with the excruciatingly slow pacing.
Refn described this movie as being like an acid trip. While I'm not sure I completely agree with that, considering shit tends to actually happen during an acid trip, I can definitely see where he's coming from.
Valhalla Rising pulls no punches and it drags you into its grim and ominous universe through hypnotic ambience and strong gruesome imagery, and makes you experience every neck-snapping, gut-busting, headache-inducing moment. If nothing else, it's provocative. And for that reason, I'd recommend watching it at least once. It's a movie that demands interpretation, and mine is by no means concrete. So give it a watch.
I'm Happy Viking, and you've just been served your recommended dosage of cinematic delight, shall we say. Rock on, and drink responsibly.